Becky here from lifetimehub.com, and I have Joyce talking to me today on a difficult subject, which is being molested by a parent in your case. So first of all, for anyone that is out there watching this who is maybe being molested by someone in their life, because I think usually someone that the person knows.
Maybe right? Always somebody.
Always, okay, almost. Maybe just tell them a little bit of your story or things happened to you that they might relate to.
Well, I was sexually abused by my father from a very young age, I think 5 or 6, right up to teenage years. Stopped when I had my first period, which I was accepted. I suppose it was the only thing I knew, so it was quite normal for me. And, you know, children have a fantastic ability. I was able to be abused 1 minute and be playing like nothing happened the next. So, you know, it's not that obvious,
right,
that a child has been abused.
Okay.
Some children, they say, go quiet, but you put it down to different stages the child is at. You very seldom think of abuse, because who wants to think about abuse?
Right.
It's the possibilities, you know?
Right. So you were abused almost every day?
Yeah, every day.
Every day. When you were little, and how do you think that affected you when you were in it as a child, and how you related to other kids and how you developed?
Well, I think a child has the ability that adults don't have of living in the now, in the moment.
Yeah.
So while it was happening, absolutely, it was horrific.
Right.
After it happened, like, you'd never forget it, and you always anticipated, you knew it was going to happen again. So part of your energy goes into preparing for the next time, and how you can protect yourself.
Okay.
And really, the only way you can protect yourself is you're practically leaving your body, you know.
Okay.
And fantasizing that's not really your dad, that it's some kind of monster has taken over, which allows you to have it, to hold on to a parent.
So is that what you would do when it's happening? You're in your mind, you're somewhere else?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
And is that common?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it could be you pick a point on the ceiling and you stare and you get lost into that.
Right.
It doesn't take away the pain.
Okay.
And it doesn't alter anything that's happening.
Right.
You know, but the reality is somewhere in your mind you're escaping, which makes it possible for you to survive through it.
Right. It is the only survival technique. Okay. And then would you say that someone, if they knew you as that child, would have known that you were being abused, or had no idea?
Well, you know, you have to make allowances for the time and the culture.
Yeah.
You know, the time when I was growing up, like, parents owned their children. And any adult could hit a child, any child.
Right.
And the neighborhood-minded children. That if you ever stepped out of line, you knew your neighbour would tell
your
parent.
Yeah.
And everybody seemed to know everybody.
Yeah.
And the only thing, you don't have to hear, like, oh, I'm going to straight tell your mother, and Jesus, shit yourself.
Yeah.
You know, so that was the culture. People looked out for each other as well.
Right.
You know, some good elements that we've really lost.
So if someone is watching this and they are suspicious that a child they know is being abused, you know, what should people have seen in you? Or
I don't know if people would have seen anything, because you know, even when I reflect on all the photographs, I did look like a happy child. Like, I was quiet, but I'd be quiet by nature anyway.
Okay.
So, you know, it'd be very, very difficult to tell.
Yeah. And why wouldn't you tell?
You're sworn to secrecy, and there's something about being a victim of rape, even as an adult. You do believe somewhere that you deserve it, and that it's something to do with you, and something you did that brought this on.
Okay.
So it's very difficult to even blame the other. It took me years to actually place the blame where it belonged.
Really?
Yeah. And most rape victims would feel that, you know. I think it's still the same today. Like, if you hear of somebody being raped, it's almost like, you know, look what she was wearing. Like, I mean, she was asking for it. And that is the mentality of most people.
Really?
Yeah.
So do you think it's the people around victims that make them blame themselves a little bit too?
I think we're groomed by society whether we like it or not. And you know, society years ago was quite different than it is today.
Yeah.
But there are still elements of that around, you know, that sense that, you know, when a girl says no, she really means yes. And, you know, like that goes for adults. There is a huge element of that still here.
But for a child who clearly, like, you know, I don't know that I understand that. How could it be your fault? You were a child, but you kind of blamed yourself.
Absolutely. But like, you have to understand when you're being abused by a parent or anyone, you are groomed for a long time before the abuse actually happens.
Okay.
And you do believe like that you're totally dependent on this person and that you are convinced that this is some form of expression of love, which is quite sick.
That's what the abuser is telling you?
Yeah. Yeah. Because it's very difficult like to be raped for a minute and being told you're loved the next. And,
yeah.
Like, it's very difficult for a child to define. And children, believe it or not, are very forgiving. They don't usually blame the parent for much. Mm. And they accept their faults. They
right.
have that ability, you know?
Right. And then as you got older, did it confuse you when you came into your own sexuality as a teenager?
I think when the abuse stopped, it was nearly worse because I was so confused. I didn't know where I was. If I did feel sexual towards anyone, I felt guilt, shame, dreadful. Like, I've been fighting all my life to get this stopped, and here am I now looking for it.
Oh, okay.
So it didn't fit. It really, really messed up my teenage years. Like, tried to commit suicide.
Yeah.
I really struggled. I mean, my first experience of having sex with somebody, I'm amazed I'm alive because I tormented him so much. Like, I wanted it and I kept saying no. And I'd go so far and I'd say no again.
Mm-hmm.
It was just absolutely torn apart. I didn't know which end of it was up.
So how did you get through that process? If you could give someone advice or hope that you do eventually, like, you feel normal, sexual, healthy feelings now, and, you know, how did you do that? Or did it just take time?
It does take a lot of time, but I think the first thing you have to do is talk. You have to talk about it. You have to really, really dig into what happened so you fully understand.
Mm.
Because only when I started writing about it and talking about it, I was able to look at a child that would have been the same age as me and realize it's not possible for that child to be guilty. But
and
I
only
did,
then you realized that? Wow.
Even that wasn't obvious enough for me. It was delving into it. It was writing about the feelings I had at the time, because that's something you would absolutely block off. And children don't really have names for feelings.
Yeah.
You know, they
yeah.
don't have a name.
Yeah.
So when they're feeling something, they don't really know what it is.
Yeah.
But a lot of it is shame and guilt. And then those feelings carry through in your adult life and you actually connect with them and they're connected also with the abuse.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's very, very difficult to separate them all. But talking is the best remedy, the best.
So if you don't have access to a counselor, do you think just tell a friend?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
I think the more you talk about it. Now, I mean, there has to be support groups out there. I'm not sure where they are, but
yeah.
you know, we got some more help when we joined the Rape Crisis Centre for counselling. A lot of the support we received from other victims was nearly better than the counselling.
Okay.
Because when you hear somebody that feels exactly like you feel,
yeah,
there's something about that actually makes you believe it's okay to be, you know, you're kind of normal.
Mm.
And it's very important to realize you're normal.
Yeah, and that you're not alone, someone else, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
So your advice is?
Talk.
Talk, hope, and try and find a support group or a rape crisis center.
Yeah.
And that's okay even for if you were molested. Can you go to a rape crisis center?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
They aren't treated differently in the system? Okay.
No.
That's good.
No. But talk and write.
Yeah.
Like if you can actually keep a diary of the feelings that you're feeling now, and you know, you'll start getting flashbacks or you'll get a memory of a particular. Try and write in depth about that. What was that like?
Yeah.
It's not easy, it's not quick, it's a long, slow process, but it is worthwhile.
Right.
And to come out believing you're somebody and you have a sense of yourself and you're not responsible. Huge burden.
Right. And it takes probably years.
Years. Well, I mean, it took us years, but then, you know, you dip in and out of it, which I did for a long time.
Yes.
When it got so deep, I felt, oh God, it's almost worse than the abuse, because you're
going back there
with, you know, you have, it's different because now you know exactly. Whereas years ago, each incident was separated because you didn't allow yourself to carry them. Whereas this, you're actually revisiting a lot. Now, it's so essential. I wouldn't like to put anyone off. It's so essential to revisit because that's where the freedom is.
Okay.
When you revisit, you see exactly what happened and what part you played in it.
Okay.
You know.
And if someone could, do you think that eventually they should confront the person that did it to them?
I wouldn't recommend that until you're really strong within yourself and you have support.
Okay.
Because that's a difficult thing because, you know, a lot of the time they deny.
Mm.
And if you have any doubts about yourself, you would that lonely. Worse
than. And you might not get from them what you think you're going to get.
No. And I tell you, the honesty is most of us only want an apology, an acknowledgement that they did something.
Yeah.
But, you know, the fear that brings up now, because for the abuser, he knows there's a possibility now he'd go to jail.
Yeah.
So unless he's absolutely sure that there's no way out of this, it's very seldom they actually admit they did it.
Okay.
But I would not do that unless you were strong and you had support.
Okay. And you're also, you didn't think you needed that anyway to heal.
No, I didn't. Like, we did prosecute your father, but mainly because we had no option.
Right.
You know, he was thrown out of the house, so there was possibilities he's abused somebody else, and we didn't want the responsibility of that.
Right.
So we had no option. We tried to get him locked up.
Yeah.
Tried to get him committed.
Yeah.
But they wouldn't do it.
Right.
You know, because they felt, you know, it's going to look like he's an old man now and we're just trying to get rid of him.
God, that's crazy.
Oh, it is crazy. But the law is crazy. The law is crazy. And if you're going through the judicial system, you need support because you're really excluded. You're really excluded in Ireland from the whole system. And once you, like, if he actually pleads guilty, it's almost like the state take over the case then, and it's like nothing to do with you.
Mm.
And it's really important that you take part in that. That's your life they're talking about.
Right.
So to push, that's why you really need support before it gets to that level.
Okay. And I know in your case, you and your sisters did try and tell people, and that didn't go anywhere. So what if someone has told somebody and nothing's happened?
Keep telling.
Find a different person.
Yeah.
And eventually somebody
will, but don't give up.
Right.
But see, an awful lot of the time when you actually tell somebody and nothing happens, it's such a relief because it takes a burden off you. You've done your job, but you're not really ready to deal with it.
Okay.
So it's important that when you're in a crisis like that, that you just find somebody that was going to challenge you to act on it and support you to do so as well.
Okay. And so life today, you went through a long process of counseling, years of counseling, you now counsel other people. And so, could you say to people, you know, that doesn't define you?
Oh, absolutely, it doesn't. It's something that happened, like everything else. How you deal with it is what defines you.
Right.
How you deal with it. And
right.
Like, you're innocent. You need
yes.
to know you're absolutely 100% innocent. You did nothing wrong. And that's really, really important. And that's the hardest message to own.
Yeah.
The hardest message. And we were blessed because we wrote the book. We had to really delve in to write that book. We did a lot of talking. And that's what made the difference, because it gave us a deep understanding of what happened and how we acted and how we internalized the pain.
Right.
And how we owned all the guilt and the responsibility.
So if you do the work, you can then, meaning counseling, you can move on and have a happy life
and
not let that be something that haunts you every day.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Because you can laugh. I mean, you can laugh, and I know that's kind of hard to believe, but humor is a great healer as well, and crying is a great healer.
Yeah.
But the reality is we're here. We do have a normal life, whatever normal life is. But we're all in relationships, and we're doing really well. And by breaking the mold, by talking to people, by pushing the case, we have freed ourselves, but we've also broken that mold so it can't continue another generation. Like,
right.
I believe this has gone on for generations in
Absolutely.
Our family.
Yeah.
But it definitely won't go on in my family.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and that's the good thing.
Absolutely.
And most of us are dreadful at doing anything for ourselves, but when we have children,
yeah,
we're much more inclined to be pushing for something better.
Right, right. And so you and your sisters wrote a book, in case somebody wants to read it and really hear about it, goes through kind of a little bit of describing what you went through.
Yeah.
And then your healing journey, really.
Yeah.
And a little bit of kind of life today, I guess, where you
are
now.
Yeah, absolutely. And it is the healing process. Like, some of the book is very graphic and very difficult to read, but that's only one chapter. And the only reason we did that was to set the context, to be sure that if an abuser picked up that book, they would be under no illusion that children like this or want this.
Right. And for someone who has been abused, they'll be able to relate to that.
Absolutely. They'll be able to know.
Because it was horrific, you know, the abuse. I don't know what people think, but yeah. It is very descriptive, but it is good to understand how horrific it was.
Yeah.
And that you are now, you and your sisters are okay.
Yeah.
You can come out of that. So the book is called
Click.
And you can you get it on Amazon?
Get it on Amazon, most bookshops. It's a paperback that's just been released, so that's going to be in the shops next week.
Okay.
And it's being released in the UK in April.
Okay. But anywhere you are in the world, you could probably go on Amazon UK and get it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and it's look up Joyce Kavanaugh, and it's called Click. Thank you very much, Joyce.
Thank you.